Hello, Bea here, and welcome back to Biology. I hope you remember what biology is. After all, we've been talking about it for a few days. It's the study of life. Where do we find life? Is there any life here? What about here? Or here? In general, I think it's safe to say that life can be found almost anywhere. Well, anywhere on Earth, that is. Plenty of scientists are looking for life outside Earth, but they haven't found it yet. So we'll have to focus our study of biology on our home planet. We call all of the living parts of Earth the biosphere. Today, and for the next few days, we'll be taking a brief look at some of the big topics in biology. And I guess it doesn't get much bigger than the biosphere. But remember those five themes we talked about on the very first day? Structure and function, stability of organisms, reproduction and inheritance, evolution, and the interdependence of organisms. For most of the first semester of biology, we'll be learning about the first two themes, which focus on biology at a very small scale. But just to give you a taste of the large-scale topics coming next semester, we are going to take a quick look at themes 3, 4, and 5 over the next few days. Today's theme is number 5, the interdependence of organisms, also known as ecology. Ecology studies the ways in which organisms interact, not only with each other, but also with their physical environment. As we go through the lesson today, see if you can spot examples of some important interactions between animals, plants, or with their environment. We said that the biosphere contains all the living parts of Earth, but the biosphere is obviously a very big place. So we'll start by focusing on the life found in a very particular part of the biosphere. Have you ever been to Yellowstone National Park? It's one of my favorite places to watch wildlife, and there is so much to learn from the interactions of the animals and even plants that we find there. Before we jump in, here are our learning goals for today. Identify important interactions in the Yellowstone ecosystem, and understand the role of a keystone species. We've established that the biosphere is a very big place, so to study it, it makes sense to break it down into smaller parts. We like to group together areas that have something in common, and we call these areas biomes. Biomes are large areas that have a specific climate and type of wildlife. I mentioned earlier that I love Yellowstone National Park. How do you think we could describe the biome there? Yellowstone's biome is known as the taiga. This means it primarily has forests of evergreen trees and long, cold winters. It is home to many different kinds of animals, including beavers, elk, moose, wolves, owls, just to name a few. The taiga tends to be found in areas far to the north, but not far enough north to be considered Arctic. We'll study more of the taiga and other biomes in our ecology unit next semester, but for now, I have a really fascinating story to tell you about some of the taiga animals in Yellowstone. And remember to keep an ear out for some of those interactions we talked about earlier. The story is about one of my favorite animals, the wolf. Did you know that until the early 1900s, wolves were very common in Yellowstone and all over the northern Rocky Mountain region? As farmers and ranchers moved into the wolves' habitat and cleared land for their own activities, the amount of space and food available to the wolves decreased. As a result, wolves sought out what food they could find, often the ranchers' livestock, especially sheep and cattle. Ranchers lost money every time a wolf attacked their herd, so they began intentionally eliminating them with rifles, traps, and poisoned carcasses. By the 1920s, there were no more wolves in the greater Yellowstone area, having all been killed by the influx of ranchers. Even the National Park Service encouraged and participated in this eradication, believing at the time that it was for the good of the ecosystem. Sounds like the beginning of a very sad story, at least for the wolves. But let's pause for a moment. What is an ecosystem? And why did the park rangers think they were helping it by eliminating the wolves? An ecosystem is an interacting group of organisms and their physical environment. We can think of it like a small part of a biome. The taiga biome goes across all of northern North America, but the Yellowstone ecosystem is an area of approximately 20 million acres in the states of Wyoming, Montana, and Idaho. Why would park rangers think that killing the wolves would help this particular ecosystem? A bit of background and trivia here. Did you know that Yellowstone was the first national park created in the U.S.? As a part of the Yellowstone National Park Act of 1872, park rangers were given not only the authority, but the responsibility to provide against the wanton destruction of fish and game found within the park. And at that time, the wolves were seen as bringing about this wanton destruction of their prey, which included deer, elk, and coyotes. In other words, allowing those populations to grow without the threat of predators may have seemed like the right thing to do at the time. By the way, a population is any group of the same kind of organism living in the same geographic area. We are focusing on the population of wolves in the Yellowstone ecosystem right now, but a population could also be all of the monarch butterflies in a certain meadow, or even all of the humans on Earth. For a group of living things to be a population, they do have to be the same type of organism. But after the wolves were removed from the ecosystem in the 1920s, did the rest of the ecosystem thrive in their absence? Not exactly. In fact, their disappearance led to a nearly catastrophic chain of events. Scientists, rangers, and park visitors began documenting the changes they saw in the Yellowstone ecosystem over the next few decades, and it began to paint a rather bleak picture. By the 1970s, the elk, deer, and coyote populations had exploded with their primary predator out of the picture. This might seem like a positive change for those organisms, but it had devastating consequences for the ecosystem. To understand these consequences, let's look at a simple food web. In a food web, we draw arrows from the organism to what eats that organism. For example, there is an arrow going from deer to wolves because wolves eat deer. A good way to remember this is that the deer physically goes into the wolf when it is eaten, hence the direction of the arrow. Pause the video for a moment to fill in the missing parts of the food web in your lesson notes. With the wolves removed, who were once at the top of the food web, the deer, elk, and coyotes could grow their population without bounds. Because deer and elk eat primarily aspen and willow trees, a huge demand was put on those populations. The willow and aspen trees had been grazed nearly to extinction, unable to grow and reproduce fast enough to keep up with the rapidly increasing population of elk and deer. This wasn't only problematic for the trees themselves, but for many other populations which depended on them as well. With no trees to nest in, the birds had almost completely disappeared from Yellowstone. With no wood to build dams from, the beavers were no longer spotted in the river. And with no shade from trees over the river, the water became too warm for most of the fish to survive. Lack of fish caused a decrease in the grizzly bear population, as trout from the river was one of their main food sources. The river itself even struggled. With no tree roots along the bank to anchor the soil and prevent erosion, the riverbank began caving in, changing the shape of the river's flow and constantly adding more dirt and minerals to the water, causing it to be perpetually cloudy and dull. It was also noticed that populations of rabbits, mice, foxes, and hawks had decreased as well. With the wolves removed, there were far more coyotes to eat the rabbits and mice, which left little food for the foxes and hawks, who were then forced to relocate. This unfortunate series of events is known as a trophic cascade and occurs when a keystone species is removed from an ecosystem. A keystone species plays an especially important role in an ecosystem and helps hold the food web together. Even though they may be small in number, they have a major impact on the way the ecosystem functions. The term keystone comes from the wedge-shaped stone at the top of an arch, which holds the arch in place. Without this stone, the arch collapses, much like the food web collapses when the keystone species is removed. Wolves were the keystone species in Yellowstone, and their removal led to a very unpredicted collapse in many other populations. Fortunately, this story has a happy ending. By the 1990s, scientists had a better understanding of ecosystems and were able to discover the mistake. Now, knowing the importance of wolves to the ecosystem, they decided to import approximately 40 wolves from Canada to be released into Yellowstone. Within 10 years, the population of willow trees was rebounding, and by 20 years later, the aspen had recovered as well. Now, if you visit Yellowstone, you will likely see healthy populations of birds, beavers, rabbits, foxes, and the crystal clear rivers teeming with fish. And of course, wolves. There are now thought to be well over 100 wolves now living within the park boundaries, with hundreds more in the surrounding areas. Their presence helps keep the balance in this delicate ecosystem. Despite worries that the reintroduction of wolves would decimate the elk and deer populations, they have stabilized to a healthy level as well, though there are far fewer of them than in the 1970s when they were overrunning the ecosystem. Occasionally, a wolf does wander into a ranch and kill livestock, so the decision has not always been popular with ranchers. But wolf kills account for less than 1% of cattle deaths in the area, so it appears to be a trade-off that is fair and reasonable for everyone. In other areas across the US today, many still promote the idea that wolves should be removed from areas where ranching is common. As a result, other ecosystems are still in danger of a similar fate to Yellowstone if we don't learn from our mistakes. Scientific knowledge alone often isn't enough. Humans must overcome political and economic barriers as well in order to protect ecosystems. As we looked at this story about the Yellowstone wolves, we saw examples of every level of classification in ecology. We also saw how important the study of ecology is in order to understand the interdependence of organisms and how careful we as humans must be when we decide to change an ecosystem. An individual wolf is an organism. All of the wolves in Yellowstone made up the population. All of the plants, animals, and their physical environment made up the Yellowstone ecosystem, which is part of the taiga biome. And that is only one of the major biomes found in the biosphere. Along the way, we saw examples of populations interacting and depending on each other, and we discovered what happens to the food web when a keystone species disappears. During our ecology unit, we'll explore other examples of interactions within ecosystems, as well as how humans fit into these ecosystems. Until then, remember that biology is not just science, it's the way of life. Hey, hey.